I'll get used to this someday. There we go. Now, clear a lot, yes. Well, good morning, happy Labor Day weekend to everybody. Special welcome to all of you this morning and to anybody who may be participating in this worship through the Wi-Fi. We have a lot of announcements to make, but before I do that, are there any individuals worshiping with us this morning who may be new to this church? If you are, raise your hand, please. I don't know here. Glad to have you with us. Glad you came in. Put your hands up again, and then there was over there.
Yeah.
Helen, we got two. So that's here and there. Well, we're glad you stopped in to join us in worship this morning. Good to have you with us.
Oh, yes.
And like I said, there are a number of announcements. The first one, I guess, deals with the fact that I'm standing here. I'm glad to be with you. If you don't know who I am, I'm Pastor Gustafson. I'm a member of this congregation. And I'm filling in today at the invitation of Pastor Don, who injured his back this past week and was in pain and not able to preside over this worship service this morning.
We will
keep him in prayer as well today. But I just wanted to ask why I'm here. And I'm really glad to have the opportunity to be with you, to share the word of God with you this morning, keeping Don in our memory too today. So, renewal of faith classes, that's always important. They will begin on September 8th. That's really around the corner. Please contact the office for more information about the faith renewal classes. And then there's a church picnic. Everyone likes to go to a picnic, I think. Free food, you know. It's September 15th after the late service. There are attendance and food sign-up sheets, as well as setup, cleanup, sign-up sheets in the narthex. So as you are leaving this morning, please survey where they may be and place your name accordingly. Then also, we did have a Bible study at 9:30 this morning, and I'm just going to put a plug in for it that in my experience, especially now, that there was Bible study between the services, so you're all always welcome to join that Bible study. The only thing you have to do is come early for this service. See? The other service follows theirs. Well, you can wake up early and go to that service and go to the Bible class after. But the point is, there is Bible study, and it's always enriching for all the people, I think. Then, joining Jesus on His Mission Workshop is coming up on Saturday. That's the 7th. Please sign up in the narthex again if you haven't already signed up for that. And we are looking forward not only to the people of the congregation here, but from other congregations to join us as we welcome Pastor Finke in to lead us in that workshop. Then Music Bingo is October 5th. There are sign-up sheets in the narthex. See Willa Jones for more information. And then I'm reminded also, everyone probably gets it in the emails, The Voice. Please read The Voice. When I had my former congregation, I used to say, please read Our Messenger. You know, please do this, because then you really know what's happening at the congregation. And you can participate in the greater life of the church with a much larger definition of what it is these different committees and mission parts of the church do. I tell you, please read The Voice. With that, I'm going to give Jerry The Voice.
Oh, good morning. So this is just a quick reminder that bell choir and choir rehearsal start this week. So bell choir rehearsal Tuesdays at 6:30 at night. Choir rehearses on Thursday mornings at 10 o'clock. And I see a lot of our choir members are here right now. I ordered 20 copies of the cantata that we're going to start to prepare, and so we still need probably 4 or 5 more people so that we have somebody for each copy of the music that I ordered. So please prayerfully consider joining one or both of those groups. It's not a big time commitment, and it's something that will, I'm sure, enrich your heart as well as enhance the worship at all of our services here. Thank you.
Gary,
you
want?
It's me again.
Okay.
Right.
I invite you to stand if you are able to begin our service with the invocation. We make our strong beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our strength, without you we are weak and wayward creatures. Protect us from all dangers that attack us from the outside, and cleanse us from all evil that arises from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
1, 2, 3.
Thank you.
We come before Jesus to confess our sins, struggles, and doubts. We take some pause to reflect on them now. We confess, Father, in you we live and move and have our being. Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near to you, our refuge and our strength. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. In the mercy of Almighty God, Christ died for us while we were still sinners. And for his sake, God forgives you all of your sins. Rejoice. You may be seated.
The Old Testament reading for this morning comes from Deuteronomy chapter 4, beginning at the first verse. Now, Israel, hear the decrees and laws I am about to teach you. Follow them so that you may live and may go in and take possession of the land the Lord, the God of your ancestors, is giving you. Do not add to what I command you, and do not subtract from it, but keep the commands of the Lord your God that I gave you. Observe them carefully. For this will show your wisdom and understanding to the nations, who will hear about all these decrees and say, surely this is a great nation, is a wise and understanding people. What other nation is so great as to have their God near them, the way the Lord our God is near us whenever we pray to him? And what other nation is so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as this body of laws I am setting before you today? Only be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is from the book of James, chapter 1, beginning at the 17th verse. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and, after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Let us rise in your able. The Holy Gospel is written in the seventh chapter of Mark, beginning with the first verse. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. And the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And they observed many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So, the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands?" He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules.' You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions." Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us at this time confess the faith we share. I believe in one God,
the Almighty, ruler of the heavens and the earth, full of grace and mercy. I believe in the Father, who has created me and all that exists. I believe in the Son, who has redeemed me by his death and resurrection. By my baptism into his name, I am saved from sin, death, and the power of the devil. He, Lord God and man, my Lord Jesus Christ, is now seated at the right hand of the Father. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who daily sanctifies me. He blesses me and guides me as I live my life in the body of Christ, the one true Holy Apostolic Church.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, peace be yours, from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. And meditate upon his word for us this morning. Amen. The text is the gospel lesson I read moments ago. So far, our text. Kathy and I have recently been watching a television show, actually reruns of a television show known as Monk. Monk is a former detective, a very, very interesting individual indeed, who suffers from OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. With Monk, this disorder manifests itself in the obsession with dirt, or perhaps I should remark his obsession with the removal of dirt. He is the super clean type of person. Forever, you know, dusting, scrubbing, polishing, vacuuming, and just generally cleaning everything. But he's not alone, because there are plenty of people who seem to worry about how things really should look, that the world should be as clean as a whistle, so to speak. But as clean as they would like our world to be and for our world around them to appear, these very same people can also be unclean. Oh yes, they can be dirty, dirty from within, inside of their hearts. They can have soiled thoughts. They can have unclean motives and decadent interests. But you know, that can be said about all people. All people can be clean and dirty at the very same time. Indeed, I would suggest this morning that all of us fluctuate in and out of these categories throughout our lifetime. If this reality or truth about life is nothing new, it isn't anything out of the ordinary, why, even the religious, you know, leaders of Jesus' day fell into the categories of being clean and unclean, which seems to be the issue of contention in the gospel lesson I read a little while ago. To be more specific, the religious leaders of Jesus' day were very concerned about what were known as the ceremonial laws of the time, with the washing of hands and pots and pans. However, they neglected something truly important. They neglected their own hearts. They neglected to clean up their own acts as leaders, religious leaders, within the kingdom of God. Theirs was indeed a major problem in ancient Israel, one that was really obvious to Jesus our Lord, which had its origin in the heart. But the story that's found in the gospel lesson that has been appointed for today is not simply a reflection of what once was, but a clear exposition of what still is. It's not simply a story about the condition of the religious leaders of Jesus' day. It is an indictment of the human condition, one humans throughout all of history have perpetuated, because it's one that we cannot correct. It is a condition that everyone is born with, a heart condition that affects all and every aspect of human living. Look at the world. around us today. Look at our communities and the social structures that surround us. Look at all of the injustices that take place, the problems of other nations, as well as the problems of our own nation. You know, and I've heard people here say this too, people turn off the news because the news is so bad. It's overwhelming, it's sad, it is depressing. Listen to some of the lyrics, not only of present music, but of music from the past. Vulgarity today has simply replaced the subtle drift of yesterday's suggestive poetry. And our heroes. Our heroes on the cinema and stage, the ones in the athletic arenas, and the ones who walk the beat. The ones who lead the state. I wonder if any of the following words fit some of their lifestyles. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, folly. But we know our heroes are not the only ones with such concerns as these, are they? They're not the only ones who participate in these behaviors. Sadly enough, looking into the mirror of God's holy law, we find, oops, we all do. We all do. It's awfully upsetting, scary, but I tell you, it's also only human and truly human. It is who we are by nature. In one of the confessions, we even state the fact that we are, by nature, sinful, and now the next two words, and unclean. And what are our answers to all of this? Education, more and stricter laws, defund the police, better prisons, no prisons, higher income for the poor, a new system of behavioral modification. Everybody seems to have a new ideology or philosophy, a new method to a better life and community recovery. But the truth be told, many things have been tried, many methods have been espoused, but has anything actually been solved? That's a rhetorical question, and we all know the answer. The answer is no. It's a resounding no, which makes it all the more appalling because one would have thought, at least by now, we would have gotten things straightened out and on the right way. But here's the thing. All of our attempts have simply been exercises in futility. And the only one who seems to have the answer is what children in Sunday school always say is the answer. The only one with it is Jesus. And his answer is this. Change the heart. Change the heart. All of us need some radical heart surgery, surgery which seems impossible, because if it were possible for us to do it, we would have taken care of the problem already. However, it's not impossible, my friends, because you see, with God, everything is possible. Everything is possible. Change of heart is what Jesus Christ is espousing. Those many, many parables concerning, you know, mercy and forgiveness were stories that were pointing to that change. Even His stories about judgment are stories exposing the inevitable need for the change. I would say that the entire life of Christ, his sacrificial death on the cross for all people, the righteous one for the whole unrighteous lot, was manifest to reveal how far God would go. And that we all need this change of heart. And the resurrection. The resurrection of our Lord proves that new life can and will come forth by the power of God. And with the power of God and His Holy Spirit, hearts are changed and renewed. Indeed, our hearts have been changed. Hearts have been changed for a long time as a whole new community was formed. And that new community, which had changed with a change of heart. My friends in Christ, you see, I believe it was a change of heart that caused the early church to be so effective in its mission and ministry. Those who were the early followers of our Lord, early followers of Christ, maintained ideals and values which were like those of the Lord to whom they all had pledged their allegiance. The truth is reflected in the early title that was given to those first disciples. They were not originally known as Christians. That was a pejorative thing, by the way. They were first known as members of the way. They went about sharing the gospel, not only verbally, but also physically, sharing all that they had with others, treating those around them with compassion and kindness. They practiced their faith relationship to God religiously, caring for orphans and widows in their distress, and by keeping themselves unstained by the world. That was happening. James is only reminding them of that fact, that they must continue that. They took the call to be children of God in a serious and yet humble way, as have Christians throughout the ages. And so should we all, you see, all of us sitting here. And so the prayer of God's people, the prayer for all of us, should resound, "Create in me a clean heart, O Lord, and renew a right spirit within me." It should be our daily prayer. For when God changes our hearts by His power and word, our lives are transformed and made anew, and we are able to affect others who are a part of the kingdom of God, and also those outside of the kingdom of God, to the glory of our Father in heaven. And then, my friends, then the good news is communities will be healed and restored, and hope will be renewed, you see. And people will know there is an eternity in which that life is offered, where God, as the Good Shepherd, will lead us for the sake of His Son, our Lord. My brothers and sisters in Christ, we come here today knowing, confessing. We do. We have a heart condition, one that gives voice to sin on a regular and daily basis. But we also know and believe that through the creative word of God, the voice of the Lord, and the reality of sacramental grace, our hearts can be reconditioned. They can be transformed. They can be made new. And with that change of heart that we all will have, comes the great challenge. Comes the challenge. Some might call it mission. The challenge to lead our families and our communities to know the Lord, to seek His wisdom, to behold His truth, a wisdom, a truth, and a knowledge that offers and conveys life to our broken world. My friends, this is no superficial, like the Washington Pantheon. This is no superficial reality, but one that lies deep in the hearts of those who call themselves the children of God and followers of the way. It is, for you and me, a reality that manifests itself in acts of kindness and goodness and deeds of grace and mercy and righteousness, in simple displays of God-like care. There's a whole world with a population out there that needs a change of heart. There's a whole world beginning, my friends, with our own homes, where people need to be blessed by those whose hearts have been reconditioned by God's word and His grace. The wonder of baptism is that each of you are created with a new heart. As the old Adam, the old self, the old man, so it is called, is drowned to die in daily contrition and repentance. A new Adam, a new person comes forth. Heart that hears the voice of God and follows His wisdom, which bears fruits of righteousness. Hearts now that have been prepared to take on the disaster that is sin. The world awaits you. The world awaits each every single one of you. The question that remains is really simple, and it's this one. Do you have a heart for this? I think you do. I think you do. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let's continue at this time as we gather the offering for the day.
You told yourself with real you.
peace of our Lord. Let us continue with the prayers for the day. In our prayers today, there are several people we are to remember. Those who are sick include Randall Cabell. He's the former pastor of Leslie Benfield. He needs a kidney transplant. Bob Mylod, former member in hospice care at the time. Judy Steinman, surgery on this Tuesday. Kathy Lilley, recovering from surgery. Craig Rader, hospitalized with kidney failure and neuropathy, as well as Noretta Burke, who will be undergoing testing. And of course, we'll keep Pastor Don in our prayers. And then those mourning, passing, friends and family of Nicholas Farco, who happens to be a friend of Sam Flores. And then milestones of celebration. We have birthdays coming up with Beth Hesterman, Christine Fox Roberts, Phyllis Parker, Willa Jones, Brenda Minnick, Dolores Frederick, and Julie Lewis. And then anniversaries of marriage, Bob and Pat Barnes, and Joe and Brenda Minnick. Let us pray. The response is, Lord, in your mercy, the response being, hear our prayer. Let's pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, for all people according to their needs. Let us pray for the church, that God's word would not be crowded out by human traditions, and that right teaching would be coupled always with right living. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Let us pray for the world, that laborers would be treated fairly, that opportunities for employment and income would abound in all places. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for the orphaned and widowed everywhere, be supported and cared for, and that God's people would respond in mercy and with compassion to all who are in need. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Let us pray for peace to rule our world, to replace the wars and battles being fought, so that nations might live and be governed in peace and with the hope that lives and stable relationships can be renewed. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for this congregation. Let the Holy Spirit would fill it with wisdom and knowledge as it carries out the ministry and mission of the kingdom of God, and that all the prayers offered during this time of vacancy would be answered, culminating with a call offered to a new pastoral leader. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for all who are ill, for those who depend upon a physician's hands to correct a physical problem, for those who need the care and attention of those who practice the skills of healing. Especially, do we remember at this time, Randall,
Bob,
Judy,
Kathy,
Cray,
Noretta,
and Don. We also pray out loud the names of others not mentioned, but who are in the hearts of those gathered here this day. Bob, John. Grant to all of them the certainty of your presence and the assurance of your grace as they await the answers to their petitions. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for those celebrating joyous milestones, for those celebrating their day of birth. We remember Beth, Christine, Phyllis, Willa, Brenda, Dolores, and Julie. And also we pray for those celebrating the anniversary of their marriage. Bob and Pat, Joe and Brenda. Continue, O Lord, to bless and keep them, to guide and watch over them, that their future moments and days may be filled with joy. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray for those who mourn, especially for the friends and family of Nicholas Farco, that you would comfort them and give them hope. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen.
Amen. 1, 2, 3.
Thank you.